too.
Light the candle of peace. Peace, much like the word past, needs some qualifiers and context. Does being at peace mean that we are not fighting? Maybe things are peaceful because people are afraid to speak up out of fear. Maybe peace represents not raising your voice or entering a heated debate or everyone simply minding his or her own business. But this kind of peace looks more like apathy, which certainly isn't why we light candles during Advent.
Many names are used throughout Scripture to describe the person and the work of Jesus: Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, and Prince of Peace, to name a few. Isaiah points to peace as one of the signs that God has offered Messiah to God's people. But interestingly, Jesus says in Matthew 10:34, "Don't think that I've come to bring peace to the earth. I haven't come to bring peace, but a sword." This offers us a clue as to what kind of peace God desires. A godly peace goes beyond the lack of fighting or reservation or apathy.
Peace is mentioned at Jesus' birth when the angel said, "Don't be afraid. Glory to God in heaven and on earth peace among those whom he favors." Jesus, before his arrest and crucifixion, gathered his disciples together and said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I give to you not as the world gives. Don't be troubled or afraid." When Jesus was resurrected, he appeared to the disciples, who were hiding behind a locked door out of fear. And Jesus' first words to them were, "Peace be with you."
Peace is not the lack of conflict. Following Jesus will result in quite a lot of conflict with the world. Jesus is the Prince of Peace because the peace he offers is the opposite of fear. We light the candle of peace so that the light will burn away our fear of what following Christ might mean.
Gracious God, Father, Prince of Peace, help us to follow where your light shines. Hope is the destination of our faith, and peace gives us the courage to start the journey. In
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hebrews 11:1 says, "Faith is the reality of what we hope for, the proof of what we don't see. Hope is the destination of our faith. It is not to be faithful, trusting in what our eyes do not see. I might believe I can fly, but leaping from a tall building without a parachute is still a bad idea. I might believe that my candidate will win the election, but if my candidate's faithful voters do not cast their votes, a victory will not be possible. A hopeless faith is like getting in a car for a weekend trip, not knowing where you are going. You trust that the trip will go well and that you will return safely, but without a destination, you will wander aimlessly. Hope is what keeps us from following a blind faith. Hope is the destination."
Before lighting the candles of love and joy, we must begin with hope. The Old Testament offers prophetic word of a time when God will rescue God's people. In Isaiah, we find, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests on his shoulders." These and many other Old Testament teachings guide our faith during the Advent season for a time in which God will reconcile all things. Our hope is reconciliation, forgiveness, grace, and salvation. And that hope grounds our faith. Gracious God, ground our faith in the hope of foundation. Let us not walk aimlessly in darkness, but let us see the light that Christ will bring into the world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Joyous strains, glory. candle of love. Christina Rossetti, a late 19th century poet, wrote, "Love came down at Christmas. Love all lovely, love divine. Love was born at Christmas. Star and angels gave the sign." Jesus was the fully divine. Love came down, and fully human, love was born, Son of God. Making sense of Jesus, full divinity and full humanity, existing in the same place and same time is confusing. The Nicene Creed attempts to spell this out, saying, "We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father." It is almost funny that the best way we can describe this cornerstone of our faith is to say that Christ is of the same substance of God, or in other words, whatever God is, Christ is too.
The point is that love both came down and was born because love is who God is. God is the creator of all things seen and unseen. God is full of majesty and glory. God's presence lives intimately within us, closer to us than the air we breathe. When we learn to love God and one another, I am convinced that what we share is the very presence of the divine. Yes, it can be confusing, and there is a tension when trying to explain it, but love lies at the center of it all. We light the candle of love as a sign of the beautiful mystery of God's love. Gracious God, whose love came down and put on flesh to walk among us, help us to accept and share your presence so that the world might know your love. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And though you miss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? Your baby boy is heaven's perfect is the great.
Light the candle of joy. By now, Christmas is just a few days away. Last-minute shoppers are getting desperate. Children are out of school. People are praying that the real Christmas tree they decided to get instead of the fake one in the attic will hold on until Christmas dinner with the family. This close to Christmas time, we can easily become distracted from the joyful anticipation of the coming of the Christ child we felt earlier in the year, when Thanksgiving leftovers were still edible. If you are the one fulfilling Christmas lists or preparing a Christmas family meal, it is exceptionally easy to be burning the Advent candles at both ends, so to speak. We can all think of Christmases where we have overextended ourselves to the point where we have lost the meaning of the season. Parents can easily arrive home from Christmas Eve services unprepared for doing the work of Saint Nick. They go to bed in the wee hours of the morning, just hoping the kids will stay in bed till the time the sun comes out. By the time Christmas is here, we are tired.
It is easy to miss the joy as the calendar moves closer to Christmas. And maybe this is why we light the candle of joy last. So stop, take a deep breath, and join us in this prayer of joy. Please join us together in a prayer of unison. Gracious God, fill us with your joy, the steadfast assurance that you are with us. Help us to remember that this is a holy time, not due to our preparations or celebrations, but because you have chosen to walk among us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
From Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them.
The lesson had been completed. Jacob Marley came back and warned Scrooge not to continue to live as he had lived his life. The ghost of Christmas past had shown Scrooge his past and how he had traded love and relationships for his money. The ghost of Christmas present had shown Scrooge how, despite his riches, how he was actually poor in love. He showed him the Cratchit family and how his neglect continued to keep Tiny Tim ill and sick. And the ghost of Christmas yet to come had terrified Scrooge, showing him his own death and Tiny Tim's death. And Scrooge was committed to living a different life if only he would be gifted the opportunity to make the difference in his life. Scrooge awakes excited to greet the new day.
Excuse me, what day is it? Christmas Eve? How could it be? I mean, Merry Christmas. Of course it's Christmas. The spirits can do whatever they please. They have given me this gift, this message, and allow me to have this Christmas as an opportunity to prove that I have been changed, and change I must. I will honor Christmas in my heart and try to keep it there all year. I will live in the past, in the present, and the future. The spirits of all three shall strive within me. I will not shut out their lessons that they teach. I must get to the market. I plan to buy Cratchit, the biggest Christmas bird he has ever seen, for his wonderful family. And I must prepare to make amends to my nephew Fred and his guests. It is going to be a busy day. A busy day. but let me show thanks to you. When I first came to this place, I did so unannounced. I came in cold and broken. I can't imagine what you must have thought. Please, let me help your mission. Not with just a monetary donation, but with my own story. That you might learn the same lessons that I've learned. That you might receive the true spirit of Christmas, which is this day for change, to reorder one's heart, to look out for every man and woman. The gift of this new day, of true renewal, is the true gift of Christmas. And so I beg you that you might live Christmas every day. Just as the spirits of all three shall strive within me, oh, Jacob Marley in heaven, and Christmas time be praised for this, I say it on my knees. Merry Christmas to you and yours, and may God bless us, everyone.
Don't you just love Ebenezer Scrooge? I mean, the first week that Ebenezer was with us, he was a mean and cold individual. But I think we too all found a part of ourselves within Ebenezer. There are times where we are the people who look at the world and say, bah humbug, forget it. But haven't you seen the change in his life over the last few weeks? After finding our own bah humbug, we then took a trip to the past with the ghost of Christmas past. Scrooge saw moments of his own life that were happy and moments that were sad. And he began to realize that he didn't know himself nearly as well as he thought he did. He once loved Christmas, and now he despised it. He once was in love, and now all he had was his money. He traded all his happiness for his gold, for his riches. We found in our collective past that Christ will come no matter what is trying to stop Christ. We visited World War I and found that even on the battlefield, Christ could still appear and make a difference. We were reminded of our own Christmas of 1968 when this very church burned. And still, just days later, Christmas was celebrated in full. Nothing lesser, but fully celebrated. In our own present, we have seen the work that is taking place to ensure that we still celebrate Christmas. And we had our eyes open to how easy it is for us to not be present, but to bend our understanding of the world and to dismiss the needs of others. Scrooge found himself at the home of his employee, who he underpaid, and realizes that he knows very little about the Cratchit's home life. Both of us realizing how we either dwell on the past or we rewrite the past to help us avoid our present. We too do the same with the future. We worry about it, we have fear, or we sugarcoat our idea of what might come in the future, so much so that it makes it virtually impossible for us to see things as they truly are in this moment. What we must do is pray that God opens our eyes to the needs that surround us and pray that we can offer hope and peace to others. And two, just a little bit of the love from God that we might find some joy in it as well. And just this last Sunday, we too considered our future. How God is a God that is beyond time and space. God is a God that was, that is, and that is to come. Now that means that God has a plan, that God is in control, and that God can put our sufferings and our struggles to good in the future. For the future is truly in God's hands, and we should have a good faith that God will continue to walk beside us through whatever we're going through. And we too are reminded, while tonight we celebrate the first coming of Jesus as a baby, that there is still the next coming where Christ will come again. And so we are still optimistically awaiting the coming of the Messiah in the future. But today is Christmas Eve. In the story A Christmas Carol, this is the night that the ghosts visit Ebenezer Scrooge, and when he awakes in the morning, it feels as if he has been dreaming for hours and days. And so when he awakes, he asks a boy on the street, "Boy, what day is it?" And the boy responds, "Why, it's Christmas Day." And Scrooge celebrates in that moment, like what I imagine a lineman does when they score a touchdown. He sits there and he says, "I am as light as a feather. I'm as giddy as a schoolgirl." And he declares that he will keep the teachings of all of the ghosts that have visited him the night before and make the difference every day. Now, specifically, Charles Dickens writes that Scrooge will keep Christmas all the year long. And so that brings me to a question. How long does Christmas last for you? I mean, is your Christmas tree up for New Year's Day? Or is it back in the box on Canadian Boxing Day just 24 hours after the 25th? Is it on the curb by the next garbage day? That is, if it's a real tree. I think it is kind of telling that we say that this is the 2020 Christmas season. I mean, how easily we forget that the 12 days of Christmas actually starts on December 25th, and it will take us through to Epiphany on January 6th of the next year. The Christmas season isn't contained just in 2020, but it is 2020-2021. The Christmas season carries us from the old year into the new year, just as the gift of Christ will carry us to a new life, from the old life to the new life. It takes us to a new start, a new life, a redemptive day that allows us to start over fresh. And it's what makes Scrooge declare that he is as light as a feather, that his baggage has been given over to the Lord, and that he now has a new outlook, a new way of seeing the world. Our new start can't be just for one day long. It can't just be for December 25th. And we can't forget that God has offered us this gift of Jesus Christ and that we must take it with us each and every day. And our new start can't just be 12 days either. No, we have to learn to keep Christmas in our hearts each and every day. Now, the biblical birth narrative from the Gospel of Luke says, "And Mary kept all that had happened close to her heart, and she treasured it, and she thought about it often." In other words, Mary was the first person to keep Christmas in her heart and keep it all the year long. I've mentioned throughout this sermon series the idea that whatever day that you choose to allow Christ into your life, or possibly back into your life, that that day is your Christmas. And each day that you choose to act upon the generosity of Christ and offer people God's peace and God's hope and God's joy and God's love, that day too is Christmas. My nanny would often tell us kids that, you know, if you learned something new today, today was a good day. But I think God would say every day that you live as if it were Christmas is a day well lived. It is Christmas. Merry Christmas to you. Christ has come into the world. And our Advent wreath is complete. But realistically, how will we keep Christmas? For Christ was here throughout this Lenten season. Christ is here now, and Christ will be here tomorrow, and Christ will be here the day after that, and Christ will walk through life with us each and every day. And so what can we do to treasure this gift in our hearts like Mary does? Well, the past. By searching the stories and finding ways that God has acted in the past and in your past, and by being thankful for a God who was, and by holding on to the present, by seeking to do Christmas daily. To do Christmas means to give someone the hope who has none, or to offer peace to someone who is hurting. We do Christmas by being joyful. We do Christmas by sharing Christ's love. And when we are like the shepherds and we go and we tell the story of Jesus, we are engaging in the Christmas story. One way that we might consider holding on to the past and the present within this idea would be to journal. To write about what God has done for you each and every day, to write about what you've prayed about, so that a week from now you can look back on that journal and say, oh, I asked God for that here, and God supplied that here. It can help us be more thankful and attentive to that which God is doing in our lives. But we also have to consider the future. By waking up tomorrow and saying to yourself, you know, it doesn't have to be another 364 more days until Christmas. By not putting off the idea that we have to wait until we hear the first shouts of Deck the Halls or the first croons of I'll Be Home for Christmas. But no, instead, planning how you will celebrate Christmas tomorrow. Christmas, the birth of Christ, the Messiah, it is a gift. A new gift that you can receive each and every day, a new start, something new that you can build upon. But either way, it's a gift, and if we could just capture the wonder of this season and take it with us each and every day for the next 365 days, and then the 365 days after that, and years to come, then our days will be merry and bright. So Merry Christmas to you and your family. To you and your friends and your neighbors. Merry Christmas to my brothers and sisters in Christ. And may you keep Christmas in your heart and live it daily. Amen.
gift of Christmas, and might we together know that because of the gift of Christmas, even the meanest old man can be changed. Might we remember that the first Christmas from so long ago that ignites the spark of Christmas miracles? That in our present that we might still feel the power of that babe of Bethlehem. And they came, that babe came to offer us a new start. And might we keep that spirit in our heart each and every day. That our Christmas future might not just be for today, but every day. For all we can change, for we all can be changed, because the miracle that we have is seen in Christmas past and Christmas present and Christmas future. So may God bless you and you and you and you. And you.